Good evening and welcome to Cover to Cover. We've two very different popular novelists to consider this week. First, Dick Francis, who has just published his 25th novel, Bolt, and it shows every sign of being every bit as successful as the first 24. Michael Moorcock has contented himself with republishing, in very handsome single volumes, his science fantasy trilogies that have proved so popular since the late 60s. We'll be looking at the Chronicles of Corum in particular, and Michael is here in the studio to discuss his prolific and varied output. We'll also be examining Life is Elsewhere, a new novel by the great Czech writer Milan Kundera. And we'll end the programme by asking David Frost's joke writer, Fred Metcalf, why on earth he thought himself qualified to compile the Penguin Dictionary of Modern Humorous Quotations. Many people claim acute literary judgment. Few actually earn hard cash by applying it. Ron Pollard is one of those few. He sets the odds for Ladbrokes on the Booker and Whitbread prizes, and he'll be tipping winners for us today. Joining him is Iain Banks, known to his friends, I learned from a newspaper article, as El Bonco, but known to the literary public as the author of a stupendously successful first novel, The Wasp Factory, which displayed a vivid and horrific imagination. And I'm also pleased to welcome Rosalind Coward, lecturer in media studies at Reading University, whose recent book, Female Desire, bravely attempted to take stock of our understanding of femininity 20 years into the feminist revolution. But first, Dick Francis. I first started reading Michael Moorcock in the late 60s, when he was not only the editor of New Worlds, the best science fiction magazine that Britain has ever produced, and lyricist for the rock group Hawkwind, but also the most prolific novelist writing in Britain. He practically invented the science fantasy genre with the epics of his heroes Hawkmoon, Corum and Elric. Although he has slowed down of late, he has already published one book this year, Letters from Hollywood, in which he reveals in an aside that many of his early books were written in 2 days, though he confesses that he really needed 3 to give them that essential bit of extra polish. Were they really written that fast?
Well, some of them that fast. 3 days was norm. But I started slowing down in my 20s and got to 4 or 5 days. Now it takes me about 3 weeks.
Still only 3 weeks to write a novel?
For a novel of that kind, yeah. A genre novel.
Yeah. But you say a genre novel, and yet one of the astonishing things about these books is that you practically invented a genre. I mean, you took this kind of weird mixture of a medieval world, a certain amount of magic, a certain amount of science fiction, and put them together. When you say they're a genre, they're a genre you've invented.
Well, I think I probably had a fair amount to do with putting together that specific kind of genre. Although I borrowed an enormous amount myself from the Gothic, for instance, and from various 19th century romantics. So I mean, all I really brought to it, I think, is I just had sort of a wider influences than most people at the time, so I could pinch more without being detected so easily.
Why do you think that it's so popular? What is the actual appeal?
I think in hard times people turn to fantasy. I think that's a lot of it. In the 30s, there was a sort of a large demand for the Conan stories that are now done as films.
Yeah.
And I also thought that was quite a lot to do with unemployment. And, you know, Hollywood movies and things like that. I mean, you know, the more glamorous things are, frequently it means that the less glamorous things are for the average person.
But why the past? Why not a glamorous future?
Ask the Tory party. I think in times of reaction, people look back to a glorious past, however mythical it is. And I think that's the other thing. I mean, if you want this cheap theory, it is that people tend to feel nostalgic about a more romantic, more glamorous past. I mean, the historical novel is a pure example of that.
One of the things that links all of your work, or at least all the work that I've read together, is a very strong sense of an end of civilization, whether it's the end of the 20th century with the end of the Russian Revolution, the end of the Carthaginian Empire, the end of Byzantium, and indeed in the Chronicles of Corum, there's a great sense of an end, a passing of ages.
Well, it's not so much ending as change, I think, that I'm interested in. I'm interested, in society in flux, in which frequently people will say it's an end, but in fact it isn't. You know, I mean, it's just an ongoing thing. So the other thing is, I think just being sort of raised during the war, sort of it's my main experience, is a sense of the end of things. I mean, you develop quite a liking for ruins. I mean, if you've been brought up amongst ruins, you know, then suddenly somebody starts wiping them all out, putting up these bloody buildings. You know, you get upset. They're your ruins.
Right. Okay, Iain Banks, you're a kind of science fiction addict. What did you make of this?
I thought it was a thoroughly enjoyable, very good science fantasy book. I think there's limitations that show up, the limitations of the genre, of sort of the sorcery itself, and Michael's writing, which you know, I know through some of the things that he's done, I'd like very much. He can write an awful lot better than this. And I said that is not, in a sense, Michael's fault in not being able to write. It's just that the genre imposes certain limitations upon you. I think actually a lot of writers perhaps aren't quite so talented. I actually find that an advantage because they've got something to work on. It gives them something they can actually aim for, in a way of it gives them a template, if you like. I think with a writer of Michael's prolific imagination, it's almost it is a limitation. It sort of constrains him within those sort of lines. But no, it's got a humanity and a wit behind it, which a lot of the average stuff, if you like, in Sword and Sorcery doesn't have. But it comes complete with all the requisite stuff, you know, a brave hero and really nasty baddies. Coming from the East, as they always do seem to, I think that's remarked upon in the books. And enchanted isles and magic armour and floats of invisibility, whatever, and lots of capitals. You must always have lots of capitals in Sword and Sorcery books. If you don't have lots of capitals, then the fans just don't know you're not taking it seriously and they won't buy it. Mm. So you must have lots of capitals, probably on the first page, if possible, as well. So we've got just about the records, a number, I'd say, you know, it just looks about right, I'd say.
Ron, what did you think of it?
Well, when I first looked at this book, as you know, I'm not into books, really, but I thought this is not for me. But what a surprise I got, eh? It's a magnificent book. I was absolutely captivated and enthralled by it. I've been unable to finish the book, but I shall finish it at the earliest possible opportunity, because I think that Michael Moorcock is a man of immense talent, and I look forward to reading other books of his. I really, really did enjoy this. Yeah.
You've got, as far as I know, about 70 books stretching in front of you, so there's a kind of, if not a lifetime reading, at least quite a lot. Rose, what did you make of it?
Well, I have slight problems with the genre, the sword and sorcery genre. It's not one that kind of immediately entrances me in that way. I have problems with the sort of symbolism that pervades, you know, the swords and the stallions and the rams and the oak tree, you know, all the titles of the books in it. I mean, they seem to be sort of very phallic and kind of off-putting. However, having said that, I did also actually find it a very pleasurable read, actually. And I think it's quite an interesting book in that I did find that you could... It didn't do what those normal sword and sorcery books in the sense that it wasn't kind of loaded down with ethical and moral questions.
There's a moral sort of framework in there, I think. And there's this thing about, in a sense, it's not really, you're not really dealing with sorcery as such, it's different levels of science. But I think that goes back to something that Mike Arthur C. Clarke said about any sufficiently well-developed science will look like sorcery to more primitive peoples. But
yes, I like that.
That does come out of it. You know,
I did. Actually, that was the one aspect of the book that I did find particularly interesting, was the idea that you know, the defunct race actually had left behind bits and pieces, which the emergent race were actually using as bits of magic and religion and sorcery. And I thought that was all really quite an interesting sort of insight into as you say, change in general. Mm. But nevertheless, I do find, I think there is an interesting question about sort of sexual enjoyment of these books, actually, because I phoned up my friends who live in a sci-fi mad household and took a kind of poll on Michael Moorcock, and there was a 50-50 split, and it was a very interesting division on sex lines, that all the men were really very keen, and the women had reservations.
Well, I think I've got a larger readership amongst women in America at the moment, for instance.
Really?
I don't know why that is, but that's That's how it goes. I agree with you completely about the phallic imagery. Phallic imagery was actually deliberately picked.
Well, anyone who wants to get started on Michael Moorcock, The Chronicles of Quorum is published in hardback by Grafton, though countless other Moorcock tales are available in paperback.